solutions to money, relationships, wellness, and more. Shine a light onto your day and into your life. Power Your Life with Dr. Joanne White.
Welcome to Power Your Life. I'm Joanne White, your host, and my first guest has a most impressive career. I'm a fan already. For over three decades, Deanna Williams has remained a constant force in the entertainment industry. From her radio days as a DJ to media coaching some of the biggest stars and musicians and athletes in the world, you can say that Deanna Williams has been an inspiration and an influence to many in her lifetime, and she's here with us tonight. Welcome, Deanna.
I'm so elated to be with you, Dr. Joanne.
Well, you are incredible. I've researched you. You do everything. You've been a producer. You've been a writer. You've been worked in TV, on radio, an ambassador of Afro-American music. You've gotten the Liberty Bell. What haven't you done?
I'm still working on my cooking skills.
Me too.
My family would tell you that. Yeah, I'm trying to get to be a better person in the kitchen.
So you have, the last 10 years, you started to coach stars.
Actually, the last 20 years.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm a celebrity strategist, and as you mentioned, I work with an array of individuals, prominent, emerging, as well as established individuals in sports, entertainment, executives as well. I coach a lot of corporate executives.
So what's involved in the coaching?
Well, the basic tenets of journalism are who, where, what, when, how. And that's what I deal with, the who, what, where, when, why, and how of an individual. So let's say they have a new record. We talk about, I help them develop their talking points. And oftentimes, you'd be surprised, people who are performers, entertainers, they can get in front of a crowd of thousands of people, but a one-on-one like you and I are doing now is a little challenging for them. So I help them with language, approach.
So it's not the music end of it that you're helping them with. It's
no.
more
how to be
more personable with and how to respond to questions.
Absolutely.
You actually taught, you and I had a conversation, and you said that Maya Angelou has been an incredible inspiration to you. In what way?
Well, I watched her going home celebration the other day, and the
right.
wonderful comments from the First Lady, former President Bill Clinton, to Oprah, to his her family,
right.
her son, grandson. It was quite touching, but as a woman, I was greatly influenced by her poetry, her novels, her statements. I watched before her death and since her passing, the wonderful gems that she has left us, everything from justice to laughter. And that was one of my favorites when I watched her with Dave Chappelle
right.
on the Iconoclast. What she had to say about the need for us to laugh and to lighten it up when we consider all the problems in the world. She was like, laugh, smile, it'll make you feel better. So considering who she was and her contribution, one of the most notable human beings, approximately 7 billion people on the planet.
Amazing,
now,
right?
She will be remembered for as long as human beings are on this planet.
By everyone,
yeah.
Really. She had an impact on everybody's
life. Every generation.
It had nothing to do with color or race or anything like that.
That's what made her so remarkable
right.
as well,
and
that she transcended color, race, class, all of that.
And she also taught people to love themselves.
Exactly.
And that's very important, to feel empowered. And
yes, ma'am.
That's a message that everybody needs to hear.
Everybody, despite color, regardless to
right.
whatever.
Right.
Yeah, so that's why she was a big influence on me. As a woman, as a mother, I admired how she moved on this planet and the contribution that she made in her art, in her very breath and living. And so how could we not be inspired by that?
Right. Well,
yeah.
You inspire so many people too by what you do. How did you get started?
Well, let's start with the lovemaking process that my parents engaged in Philadelphia, which is where one of my homes
right.
is right now. My mother tells me I was created in Philadelphia. And I was imbued by my parents and my family, very loving, Puerto Rican, African-American family, so I had the collard greens and the plátanos, you know, a lot of great food, but great energy and an abundance
and
of
love.
An abundance of love and encouragement, where my mother and father told me that you can anything that the mind can conceive and believe, you can achieve. And that has been my longstanding mantra these last 60 now, so these last 60 years. my parents, and then Kathy Hughes, who was the founder of Radio One, TV One, the company that I currently
work
with.
And you're working with that now.
Yes, and I've actually coached Miss Hughes as well. So she is, like, people know Oprah Winfrey, but behind Oprah is Kathy Hughes, and she is the owner of a television network as well as a major radio network, web portals, and much more, and she was one of my mentors.
So what are you doing on the show?
What am I doing on this show?
On the one on the radio show.
Oh, my radio show. Okay, I thought you were saying this show. No, we're empowering
we're doing a great job.
We're empowering
here,
folks.
I know.
My radio show is on Old School 100.3. I am the co-host of Soulful Sunday. It airs 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And I play classic soul, Motown, Philadelphia International, Stax. And I do interviews with a lot of the artists from the days gone by that you and I grew up listening to, and also do interviews with people who are making a difference in our community, and that's important to me.
You've also done so much in terms of activism. Let's sort of look back a little bit. What has been one of your most powerful moments for you?
Well, growing up in the Bronx and Harlem, I knew nothing about the legislative process.
Right.
And some years ago, after I established a nonprofit organization called the International Association of African American Music Foundation, I wrote President then Clinton asking him to host a reception in the White House to celebrate June, Black Music Month, which just passed. And my ex-husband, Kenny Gamble, was the founder and creator of this. And the White House said, well, we see where President Carter hosted a reception, and he said June is Black Music Month, but he did not sign a presidential proclamation. So why don't you go get some legislation and then come back to us, and then we'll do something with you. So one of my proudest moments was years later, when after Senator Arlen Specter, who was gone before us, and Congressman Shaka Fatah actually introduced the legislation that got passed in the House that said June is Black Music Month. And why is that important, Dr. Joanne? Because it is American music. It is one of our greatest exports around the world.
Yes, it is. Thank you so much, Deanna. We'll be right back.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Joanne.
We'll be right back afterwards with Deanna Williams. Thanks. Welcome back. We're back again with celebrity media coach and the founder of Influence Entertainment, Deanna Williams.
Oh, it's great to be back with you, Dr. Joanne.
We can do this forever, as far as I'm concerned, but we only have a little bit of time.
Yes.
So you have really worked with so many famous people, too. Let's kind of do a little bit of going back into history and back into your career.
Okay.
Deanna Ross.
Oh. She was a friend of my ex, Kenny Gamble, and it was a high point for me to meet her because I had been a fan of hers in the Supremes and then when she did her solo career. So, yeah.
Now, you're also in the Guinness World of Records, another feat for you. Tell us about that.
I had an idea
years
ago to do the world's largest line dance. And when Don Cornelius made his transition, I went to my boss and I said, okay, let's honor Don Cornelius and Whitney Houston because they died about a week apart, around the same period of time. And so before the steps of the Philadelphia Art Museum, we amassed a crowd of 3,000 plus people. And we went for Guinness World Record. We worked with Sheila Simmons and another group of community leaders, Amir Khan and E. Stephen Collins, and we pulled it off. And it took a minute for us to get the notice that we had received the status, but we hold the record, I say Philadelphia, because I presented the mayor, Michael Nutter, with the actual certificate, which is in City Hall now. We hold the record for the world's largest soul train line, and I was one of the primary organizers. So that was another high point. That and delivering the commencement speech at our alma mater,
Temple University
last year, yeah.
So in terms of community activism, because that's also one of your signatures here, tell us something that really inspired you through that.
Well, as a radio personality, I've been on the radio now 40 years.
Right.
I use the microphone as a platform to espouse information that is going to entertain, but educate as well.
Right.
I'm about, just as you are, empowering people to live a better quality of life, a quality of life where you can sit back and say, I am passionate about what I do. I'm excited about every moment, every second that I live. That's how I feel. So when I'm on the radio, I'm trying to brighten people's days, not just with the music that I play, but what I say and what I present in terms of information. And so that's what my life is about. And using music, in the case with me, through the International Association of African American Music Foundation, using music to lift the spirits of people.
Which music is so important, and
it has that universality. Absolutely.
And it does lift people's spirits.
Absolutely.
So what I find too is that when you and I had a conversation, your humility is just amazing. Oh. You've done so much, and you're such a beautifully prominent figure, and yet you're so humble. How do you get that way?
Mother, father. Like I referenced my parents and my grandmother, Bienvenida Vives, who helped raise me. I'm Latina and African American. And I just come from a family that was about service and love. And so I've been imbued. I believe the Creator has given me a special gift of communicating and touching other human beings as I'm touched. I mean, there's 7 billion of us here on the planet. I wish I could meet every single person and hear their stories and make a difference in some shape, form, or fashion. So how blessed are you and I to be on television and radio, write books, speaking engagements, where we have a chance to touch people's lives?
It's very special.
It is.
It really is.
Yeah.
And you are very special.
Thank you.
Tell us a story. Thank you. Tell us a story about somebody that you actually coached.
Ooh, well, I've coached so many people. You know, when I get asked, favorite client or least favorite client.
Favorite. I don't want
I've worked with, yeah, I've worked with so many. I'll tell really quick because I know we're limited on time. Faith Evans, who was the widow of Biggie Smalls.
Right.
Every time she did an interview, people wanted to know about Tupac Shakur, Biggie Smalls. They didn't want to know so much about her. She graduated, she went to Fordham University as a marketing major. She writes her songs. She has a great voice. She herself is a fabulous talent.
So how did she need coaching? Why
Well, she needed coaching because she didn't know how to handle these questions about her deceased husband, the alleged affair with Tupac Shakur. So when I worked with her, we tackled those things.
Because the media can be tough with
absolutely, that. And that's all people wanted to know immediately. So I said, we're going to start with answering those questions without you being asked. We're going to take it to the hoop.
Good idea.
We're going to take it to the hoop. And once she started doing that, she said, I was young when I got married, thrusted into fame and fortune. Imagine if that were your life. It was a tough life. And so what I taught her to do was to appeal to people's sense of consideration and sensitivity. And it started working for her, and she learned how to handle those questions with greater ease, to the point where she was on the cover of Ebony, Jet, Essence, and things turned around. So Faith Evans was a lot of fun to work with, but I have a lot of stories of artists and people, and we just don't have the time. So I love all my clients. I love the opportunity
to
help them.
So when they come to you, Deanna, what are they asking for?
Well, it's different for different people. If they have a book project, they want to figure out the best way. For instance, I've worked with T.I. on his books. How do we talk about this book? He was doing The View with Barbara Walters. He had just gotten out of prison. So we tackled how to answer the tough questions about his gun charges, going to prison, writing this book while he was in prison with David Ritz. So it depends. It's different.
So it's very, individualized.
Usher, I work with him. He is dyslexic, and he had never talked about it publicly. So he wanted to figure out what was the best way to talk about being dyslexic.
And be comfortable with it, too.
Be comfortable and help other people who are facing similar issues.
You've worked with Rihanna, too.
I worked with Rihanna on her very first album. She was concerned about her accent. She felt that she's Bayesian, and she felt that her accent would not allow Americans to understand her because of the accent. But we figured it out. Her accent has lessened some, and she's one of the biggest superstars in the world.
And she's really gotten past that, too.
Yeah, she's gotten past it. And I told her, I said, you're going to be a big star. Listening to the music, experiencing her persona, I predicted that one, and that's a prediction that came true.
You are an inspiration to me and to so many people. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. Do you ever have a good strategic plan and wonder why it fails? Up next, we have some expert advice that may help you understand why, and also tools for being a persuasive marketer. We're back with our next guest, the managing partner of the Walls Torres Group. Daria Torres is here with advice on how we can all grow professionally and as leaders within our industries. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Joanne. I'm happy to be here.
It's my pleasure, Daria. So you actually have worked with Fortune 500 companies, with large corporations, with actually even prominent universities.
Yes.
Doing strategic planning and so much more. So when people are actually involved in strategic planning, oftentimes they have this great, presumably this great plan that they think of, and then something happens, it doesn't work. Why isn't it usually, what's the problem? Why
yeah.
What happens that makes it not effective?
I mean, I think that's a great question. What I think about is anytime I talk to a client who is pursuing a strategic planning effort is, are you doing it for the right reasons? Meaning, are you doing this because it's part of a ritual, part of a routine that you think you must adhere to every 3 to 5 years? Or are you doing it because you actually are committed to pursuing the right direction for your organization and discovering what that is through a collaborative process? The reason that most plans fail that are the right intent is habits don't change.
So they're using old habits that haven't worked in the past and they're applying it to a new strategy, but the strategy may be brilliant, but the
absolutely.
And it's
in the execution, right?
Right?
So if habits don't change, the strategy just becomes an appendage to your daily operations and is not embedded in the fabric of what you do day to day. And in essence, nothing changes.
What if somebody comes to you and you ask that question and they say, we're doing it because we're supposed to do it. We have to do it. We're not really that committed. We're not excited. And we really don't believe in working with a team to kind of get that energy and get that input. What do you do?
You say, stop. Do not pass go. You say you need to establish that readiness or else the investment of time, the investment of intellectual energy is wasted. So it's important to recognize when the preconditions for success are not there. And certainly as an advisor to a client, it would not be appropriate for me to engage in that kind of work if the readiness piece is not there.
So they have to get their own readiness piece together before you step in and help out.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there is certainly a dynamic that can unfold where teams can be coached through that process. And certainly that would be something that, if there was an appetite for it, I would be more than happy to drive.
But that's important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because you want them to be successful. Many people say, oh, the reason his business or her business succeeded is she or he were lucky.
Mm.
So, and I'm wondering, really luck? Does luck have anything to do with business success?
Well, you know, I think it ties to what your last guest was talking about. You asked her about this, the humility piece.
Right.
I think, you know, what people typically refer to as luck is actually disguised by their humility. It starts with that. You have to have a kernel of humility to recognize that you're flawed. There's imperfection there. And that drives then curiosity. Curiosity to know more, to experience more.
So imperfection. I think we all are better off if we do recognize our own imperfections and at the same time recognize that there's something within each one of us that's very brilliant.
Sure.
So that we have that real balance.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And then I think you discover through a process of investing, growing. There's a great quote by Benjamin Mays that says, the tragedy in life is not failing, it's failing to have a goal. So you have to recognize there's some higher level for you to reach before you even will take that first step.
Why does persuasion factor into successful leadership?
Well, I think any business, the aim is to generate additional interest, generate awareness, and you have to start with looking at what are all the different ways that I can compel someone to have that interest. There is ethos, which is credibility,
right.
There's logos, logic, and
right.
There's pathos, which is having that personal connection. And unless you're hitting on all three of those levers.
So you need all three.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Now, Aristotle would say you only need logos, but that's
right.
We know that that's flawed.
So when you're actually consulting with the leaders, how do you help them get to that place in engaging all three?
Well, you have to be able to translate it into something tangible. So for instance, think about the Viagra ads.
Okay.
When you think about a Viagra ad, you see millions of men use this successfully. That's the ethos, that's credibility.
Right, so there's so many people doing it, that why not me, right?
Absolutely, but you could come from another angle, which is the age is here for you to do what you are meant to do. that speaks to just that heart connection, the pathos piece. The logos is all the side effects and the drug chemistry.
And which is in the small print,
absolutely,
too. You don't want to look
absolutely
at that.
So you have to consider all those angles.
When you coach leaders and consult with leaders and do the whole, you're a strategist, what do you find is an important trait of, or even two traits of a strong leader?
It's so hard to narrow down just one or two, but I'll do my best. I think authenticity is key. I think because people can tell if you're putting on airs, if you're putting up a facade, and we can't be chameleons, right? So you hear about situational leadership, have different styles for different circumstances, and I agree with that. However, your true self must come through in all of those situations.
And that ties in too, Dario, with the persuasion, because unless if you're not authentic, people are not going to really buy into it, and you're not going to be able to persuade them.
Absolutely. People can smell it a mile away. Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about your background.
Sure. So I came to consulting and business through first working in engineering, and I think it's an interesting tie to have a blend of experiences. Certainly that's where all creativity and innovation comes from, is the intersection of ideas. So first starting in engineering with a technical background gives you kind of an analytical approach.
And you have it all. Thank you so much, Daria.
Sure.
Power Your Life will be right back. Ahead, find out what's hot for next week. Did you ever think that you're not creative, or worse, compare yourself to someone you think has been born with all the creative genes? Get rid of those thoughts. They're just not true, and they're just another way to undervalue your own greatness. You can develop your creativity with your own personal flair and style. Here are a couple of ideas to take away tonight. Keep your curiosity alive. Look around your environment, your home, at your partner, and your kids with new eyes. And above all, let go of judgment of you. Find new routes to work, new games with your kids, new recipes, new friends, and don't get stuck in the same old. Shake it up a little and try out a new hobby, a new idea. When you do, you may surprise yourself and discover a new beauty or a new side to you that you really admire. Thanks for being with us tonight. And on next week's show, get the lowdown on effective ways to lose weight, improve your health, and reverse the aging process. Don't miss it. Remember that you have the power to power your dreams and power your life. Thanks for joining us.